everybody. Welcome back to the Tipsy Ghosts. We're your tipsy hosts, Sarah and Lindsay.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Hey. So what are we talking about tonight, guys?
Oh, my God.
Sarah's really excited about it.
Yeah, I was so excited. We're doing another group project, though.
Yes.
I love these.
Over one Reach of out. Our favorite little types of stories. Yes. We're doing like an urban legend slash a mythological figure.
Says so you.
Well, I'm trying to think of like legend.
He's a legend, okay?
He's a legend. We're doing Bigfoot. It's a Wookiee.
Are you trying to tell me that he's not a Bigfoot?
His name's not Chewbacca.
Chewbacca, I think, might be a Bigfoot.
I think Chewbacca was inspired by Bigfoot.
I could see that.
Hence my Wookiee noise.
Oh, Bigfoot.
Big feats.
Sasquatch.
Yeti.
Yeti. Abominable snowman.
What?
That's the cousin.
Oh, dang it.
Abominable.
Harry.
Harry and the Hendersons.
Harry and the Hendersons.
Yeah. Damn it, Lindsay. That was supposed to be one of my sightings.
Sorry.
Well, whatever you want to call him. It's
Harry.
Harry is described as a large, muscular, bipedal, ape-like creature, roughly 6 to 9 feet in height.
Why are you giggling?
You know why she's giggling.
I do.
He's 69. Covered in black or dark brown or dark reddish hair. Some people also report a foul smell, as well as another key feature, his gigantic footprints.
Is that why he's called Bigfoot?
They're up to 24 inches long.
Stinky feet.
And 8 inches wide.
My God.
That is a Bigfoot.
Girthy.
You know what they say about people with big feet?
Big democracy. Big feet, big democracy.
Should be Big Abe and not Bigfoot. It's not Harry, it's Abe. Bigfoot's name is Abe.
And he reaches out his giant toes to you instead of those giant hands. I didn't even come up with that joke. You came up with that joke. I just reiterated it.
No, she did not. That was me.
Oh, was it you? Okay, yeah. So Boysen came up with it. I just did a twist on it.
Lindsay can't handle how big it is.
I got tears.
If we can bring this up in every episode, I'd
greatly
appreciate
it. Did you choke on it?
No, I'm okay.
She took it all in. It's fine.
Oh, my God. Every time I try to get it together, you guys are...
With a big...
All right, Bigfoot.
Hairy foot.
Foot.
Listen, I knew what I was getting into here
giant
with.
Giant toes.
She tried to she tried to avoid doing history herself because she thinks that that's our downfall, but really, it's creatures.
It's creatures.
Anytime I do an urban legend about a creature, it's no, not
it's
good.
Not you, it's
oh,
them.
No.
And so I came up with Bigfoot because I was like, this is a...
Bigfoot was your idea?
What? For us to cover. Because I was like, this is... I mean, he's a big story to cover.
Sure is big. Yeah. He's huge.
And I was like, it could take all three of us talking an hour just to talk about all... And then I was like,
I can do this all night.
I can go all night with Bigfoot.
Like, I'm not doing the history. I thought, Boydson, you do the history. And it's still bad. It's still...
I think we have found our Achilles tendon, and it is... Creatures. Yep.
We just can't take them seriously.
So where did all this begin?
I don't know.
Tell us.
Let me tell you. Ecologist Robert Pyle states that most cultures have accounts of human-like giants in their folk history.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, legends have existed even before there was a name for Bigfoot. The accounts differed in their details regionally, but also between families in the same community. However, certain details are the same across all accounts. Each language has its own name for the creature, but they generally can be translated to wild man or hairy man.
Hmm. Accurate.
Hmm.
Sometimes he's both wild and hairy.
Yeah, sometimes
Harry
he can
and
be
the Hendersons.
I'll hold up a Harry and the Hendersons counter. This is twice now. Sometimes he can be threatening, and in some places, children have been warned against even saying his name.
Ooh.
The thought is that if they say the name, he's going to hear it and come and carry someone off, and then they could be killed, and that's not good.
It's like Bloody Mary. Can't say the name.
Same but different.
Bigfoot. It's like Beetlejuice.
We have covered all different areas now.
I'm opening up all everything.
In 1847, stories were heard about a race of cannibalistic wild men living on the peak of Mount St. Helens. Also in this area, in 1924, there was an alleged incident in which a violent encounter between a group of miners and a group of ape men occurred. So this area is subsequently known as Ape Canyon. But not all the stories are bad. One Protestant missionary recorded stories of giants living among the Indians near Spokane, Washington in the 1840s. These giants lived on and around the peaks of nearby mountains and sometimes stole salmon from the nets of fishermen. In the 1920s, an Indian Affairs agent compiled local stories and published them in a series of Canadian newspaper articles. So they were accounts from regional tribes and all maintained that Bigfoot was real. They claim that Bigfoot preferred to avoid white men and spoke the language of the people of Port Douglas, British Columbia.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
What language is that?
I didn't know Bigfoot could talk.
Only if you're not white and are in the area of Port Douglas, British Columbia.
Dang it.
Cool.
In the 1830s, the name Bigfoot was coined by a Wyandot chief with the same nickname due to the immense size of his feet.
My God, how fitting.
Additionally, his height well exceeded 6 feet, and his strength was described as Herculean. Later on, there was a spotted elk leader, also called Chief Bigfoot.
Wow. It really covers a lot of different areas.
Even later, in the early 20th century, at least two gigantic grizzly bears got a lot of press, and each of them were named Bigfoot. So it's possible that this could have inspired the now common name of Bigfoot that is now used to describe the ape-like creatures.
It's a very common name, apparently.
In 1958, a journalist reported on a letter from a reader about a group of loggers in Northern California who had recently discovered mysteriously large footprints. The journalist joked about having discovered a relative of the abominable snowman from the Himalayas. But readers were intrigued by the story and wanted to know more. So he and his colleagues published more articles about the footprints, reporting the name the loggers had given to the creature who left them, Bigfoot. And it seems that at the time, a legend was born.
Yes, it was.
Bigfoot has the reputation for two things. One is this elusive creature that startles people in the woods. And the other is for being a giant creature that can kill even the largest animal with a blow of his hand and can make a single meal of the animal that would have been able to feed a group of men for a week. And then he just disappears. There are several Bigfoot organizations dedicated to the research and investigation of Bigfoot sightings in the United States. One of these is the Bigfoot Field Researchers Organization.
BFO.
BFRO.
I missed the R. BFRO. BFRO.
I have that too.
Maybe, like, it can sound like a fart, like...
BFRO.
BFRO.
Sounds like a fart.
BFRO.
BFRO.
So these people within the organization are those who provide a free database of reports from all across North America, and these specific reports have been investigated by researchers to determine credibility. In 2016, the University of New Mexico at Gallup had a two-day Bigfoot conference, missed it, and it cost the university about $7,000. Fun fact, the act of searching for or researching the creature has come to be known as squatching or squatchin', and is a common phrase seen on shirts and hats. So we were all squatchin' this week. Overall, Bigfoot is a pop culture phenomena and is as well known in American culture as Michael Jordan.
Oh.
Jane Goodall has been quoted as saying, "I'm sure they exist." Well, I'm a romantic, so I always wanted them to exist.
It's romantic. I love it.
Oh, okay. Well, I was tasked with talking about sightings, and if you've ever heard of Bigfoot or Sasquatch, there's literally like thousands, I don't even know, hundreds of thousands of sightings or people claiming to have seen Bigfoot or Sasquatch. There's tons of shows dedicated to it.
Mm-hmm.
The most probably famous piece of evidence is the Patterson-Gimlin film, and this is a film that was shot on October 20th of 1967 in Northern California. And it was pretty close to the Oregon border. The filmmakers were Roger Patterson and Bob Gimlin. So Patterson had been interested in Bigfoot for several years. He also wrote a book called Do Abominable Snowmen Really Exist?
That's a hard word to say. I'm not going to be able to say that.
Abominable.
Abominable.
I just need to take the time and not try to rush it. But Abominable Snowmen Really Exist. So clearly,
which I've been told is the cousin.
Okay, so he wrote the snowman, or wrote the snowman book. That's what I was trying to say.
Frosty.
He wrote about Frosty. Yes. Unfortunately, Patterson died of cancer in 1972, but he maintained right up to the end that the creature on the film was real. Gimlin, however, denied being involved in any part of a hoax with Patterson and avoided talking about it publicly until around 2005. And after that, he began speaking about it at public events and even went to some conferences about Bigfoot. So a little bit more about the film. It has 954 frames and it's about a minute long. The event, I guess what they mean by that with the creature or Bigfoot.
Bigfoot.
Which they actually end up calling, I'm pretty sure they call him Patty. So...
After himself?
Patterson.
Patterson, yes.
They called the creature Patty multiple times.
Okay. Bigfoot does not strike me as a Patty.
What's up, Patty?
Nope. Bigfoot's better name.
Patty, you're a big and scary.
Abe is a good name.
I like Abe better. Yeah. I'm going to call him Abe. So I'm guessing the event with Patty or Abe lasted about 53 seconds of the minute long footage. Mm-hmm. So both the men say that they were riding northeast on horseback, and sometime between 1:15 and 1:40, they came to an overturned tree with a large root system and a turn in the creek. When they came around the corner, there was a log jam, and they spotted a creature behind it. Abe. Gimlin later described himself as in a state of shock when he first saw this figure, and Patterson guessed the height to be around 6 feet 6 inches to about 7 feet. So he's a tall dude. Tall creature. Mm-hmm. The film shows a large, hairy, bipedal, ape-like figure, just like Boydston described, with short, silvery brown hair, kind of reddish. Patterson said it took a few seconds to get out of the saddle from the horse, grab the camera from the saddlebag, and run towards the creature. The film's pretty shaky, and as he gets a little closer, the figure looks over his shoulder at the men, and Patterson fell to his knees. The creature looks back a total of 3 times. Gimlin followed him and spotted it again, but was called back by Patterson, who felt vulnerable alone without a gun. So that was the description of this video and their interaction.
And it's
with Patty.
A pretty Patty. Famous video, like the most well-known one that you guys think of.
Yeah, I would be willing to bet that that's probably what you think of when you think of Bigfoot.
The slow motion, yeah. Walking, looking back over his shoulder.
Which they that's have the like enhanced pretty,
yeah.
pretty well in this day and age. And it's pretty crazy how much that they can actually break it down. Which you know people have done. They have enhanced yes. that to the They've max. They've
analyzed it.
Did you say analyzed?
Analyzed.
Okay, thank God. I don't know why that triggered me. I was like, oh God.
Gosh, can we stop talking?
You're right. I will stop. So, okay. After that, he called him back, you know, because he didn't have the gun. He didn't feel safe.
Right.
By that point, the horses had already run off down the stream. And Patterson and Gimlin tried to track Patty for about a mile, but they eventually lost tracks.
Patty tracks. Sasquatch man. Catch me a squatch as fast as you can.
Fuck you guys, I'm Patty.
Okay, if Bigfoot was called Patty, it never would have caught on. We would have forgotten about Patty years ago.
But also it's just kind of a, not a very fun, catchy name.
Not like Bigfoot. I bet he has big feet.
Doesn't describe him very well. Okay.
So they're trying to chase Bigfoot.
They tried to chase him, but they lost track. Mm. That was the end of their story about Patty. So a book was written by John Napier. This is just some other, you know, sightings / fun facts about our friend Patty Bigfoot. That's his official name.
I can't.
John Napier
and Patricia Abraham Bigfoot.
Pap. Pap for short. Hey, look, there's Pab. Hey, Pab. What big feet you have, Pab. Sorry.
Okay. All right. Well, so anyhow.
I forgot where we were.
Sorry. Well, I was saying John Napier wrote a book about yes, Patty Abe.
He wrote a book about Patty Abe.
Anyways, it was called Bigfoot, the Yeti and Sasquatch in Myth and Reality.
Okay.
Very catchy.
No.
He wrote about that if he had to make a decision on Bigfoot, if it does or does not exist based on hard evidence, that all things point to the fact that he does not exist. But he did say it's extremely difficult to reject thousands of alleged tracks scattered across 125,000 miles or to dismiss hundreds of eyewitness accounts. In 1974, the National Wildlife Federation funded a field study seeking evidence, but unfortunately, they made no notable discoveries Or so they say.
Conspiracy.
It's top secret. Only the president can know.
Some articles indicate that Bigfoot is actually a black bear. I'm just saying, and I don't believe it. Because black bears, I feel like, are significantly smaller, and we've seen them thousands of times. But that's just that. Lindsay, I'm sure, is going to talk about more of that. There was a study done on 30 different hair samples. Most were black bear, but it also included cow, horse, dog, wolf, coyote, sheep, goat, raccoon, porcupine, and deer. Interestingly, though, they think that two of them matched to a 40,000-year-old polar bear called Pleistocene Epoch. Nailed it.
Good job. Yep.
I should have just gone with polar bear.
That's a really old polar bear.
A press release was issued on November 24th, 2012 by Melba Ketchum. Melba was the head of a veterinary laboratory. Melba claimed that they had found proof that the Sasquatch is, quote, a human relative that arose approximately 15,000 years ago as a cross between the modern Homo sapien and an unknown primate species. Species.
Species. Species.
What the fuck did I say? Species. Species.
You're saying shh.
I put the sh in the wrong place.
Species. Wait, that's I said special. A word correctly and you did not.
Species. Species. Melba also asked for this to be officially recognized as indigenous people so that they could have their human and constitutional rights protected against those who would see in their physical... What did I fuck?
No, I'm sorry.
I tried so
Lindsay,
hard.
Lindsay, you're insulting the constitutional rights of all Bigfoot men.
Bigfoot's human constitutional rights. Oh, I was like, oh, no, fuck. You weren't doing anything wrong.
No, she's being a dick.
It's true.
I tried to hold it in. Sorry.
Bigfoot has rights too, Lindsay.
Oh, gosh. Okay, continue. No, I will keep my thoughts to myself until my turn.
Will you?
No.
Yeah.
I don't even know where I was. Melba asked for them to be officially recognized, okay, as indigenous people so they could have their human and constitutional rights protected against those who would see in their physical and cultural differences a license to hunt, trap, or kill them. So,
yeah.
Melba's trying to protect the Bigfoot.
I get the protecting. I mean, yes, I'm they have for rights. The protecting not to kill or hunt.
You protect well, those rights of Patricia Abraham Bigfoot.
The Tab. Human part caught me. Okay.
Unfortunately.
Was she laughed out?
Melba couldn't find a scientific journal to publish these results of her study. So in a weird turn of events, though, she announced that the De Novo Journal of Science did publish it. But the journal's domain had been registered anonymously 9 days prior to this. And this was the only edition that came out. So
somebody just
a little sus.
Probably just wanted her to be, yeah.
Womp womp.
Okay.
It's a good try, though.
Good try.
A woman named Sharon Hill. I feel like you need to work for this company.
Uh-oh.
Doubtful news for the committee. Oh. For the skeptical inquiry.
Yes. I don't know why you do what you do right now. You need to just switch. Quit. Call up your boss. Quit. Say, I found my calling.
For the skeptical inquiry. That's Lindsay. Lindsay reporting for duty for the doubtful skeptical inquiry.
Is that how I sound in your head?
No, actually.
I'm Lindsay.
I'm highly dramatic. I mean,
I'm here to ruin all the fun. So what did these skeptics say?
Sharon.
What did my people say?
She reported that there was some pretty questionable stuff in the article that was written.
Sure.
Including mismanaged DNA testing. And claiming that the article just didn't make sense overall. So
Sharon's a Karen.
Come on, Sharon. Yeah, she wanted the alias is Sharon.
My future coworker.
So we've all seen these giant big seems redundant.
I have seen
giant big footprints.
Like the like you seems mean redundant. Like footprints.
Yes.
Giant
Bigfoot prints.
Tracks.
Okay, yes. Tracks. That's a good word. Yeah.
Sure. Thank tracks you. That have been in pictures. You've pretty much seen them everywhere, I'm sure.
Yes. Yeah.
A lot of plaster casts have been made.
Fuck you.
Everything I say, I can't say.
Welcome correctly. To my world.
Listen, she's the one doing it.
Okay, be ready. I'll fuck you up.
You do it every time, every episode. There is not a single episode I've said everything right. Or that I've said something and you guys have just not
It's true. It's true. I deserve it. It's karma. It really is. Earlier this week, I laughed at one of my coworkers who fell down. So
you didn't learn your lesson the first time.
Did you ask if they were okay?
Yes.
I honestly don't remember. It's like a stress response, I think. I laugh when I'm stressed. We're going to go with that. Makes me sound more empathetic. They're fine.
Okay.
Yeah, they're fine. It was hilarious.
Back to the plaster cats.
Plaster cats.
Of the footprints.
They've been evaluated by experts. One expert believes that the plaster cat shows evidence of something called a dermal ridge, which could indicate that there are healing scars on the foot. There's also a body print that was believed to have been left by Bigfoot, but skeptics feel that it may have actually been left by an elk. In February 2013, an article came out that studied 111 samples of blood, tissue, hair, and other specimens thought to have been obtained from elusive hominins in North America, commonly known as Sasquatch. After this, a request was made to have the species formally recognized as Homo sapiens cognatus. Cognatus means related by blood in Latin.
Okay.
Several organizations, as Boydston mentioned, were developed, including Before.
I like it.
And perfect. North American Wood Ape Conservancy. And that's all I got for you on my sightings and evidence.
All right. I'm here to ruin the fun. So the most common thing that skeptics say, like you said, you kind of touched on it, is bears. They think it's some kind of animal, like a bear or a chimpanzee, some form of a misidentified animal. Another common one, hoaxes, is the number one thing. And I'm going to go into like more detail about this. People dressing up for fun, they're doing this for conspiracy. They're doing it because, you know, like you said, that one video was kind of the catalyst for all of this.
Right.
And so since then, they think a lot of sightings are people just dressing up, having fun. Rick Dyer was one of the more famous hoax that he pulled off. And this was in January 2014. He claimed that he had killed a Bigfoot and done DNA tests and body scans on it. He would release photos and videos of the body, but he would not release like any of the lab results, any of the scans, even though people were asking for it. So he was like, I'm going to do a tour around America with the body so you guys can all see it, that it's dead and that I killed it, but still would not provide any of the evidence that he said he had. So finally, after 2 months of being on tour in March 2014, he admitted that it was a hoax.
Aww.
He said that the body he took on tour was fake because he didn't want the real one to get stolen. So he was like, well, this is a fake body I'm showing you guys, all people who are paying money to come see Bigfoot. But yeah, he was like, a little
suspicious.
Yeah. But he's like, I do have the real Bigfoot, but still he wouldn't let anybody see it and he wouldn't really release any of the evidence. So the fake Bigfoot body they found was made from latex and camel hair. He got $60,000 for doing this tour.
Did he have camel toes?
I don't know. It's camel hair.
How about moose knuckles?
Stop it. But like $60,000 in 2 months. That's a lot of money to be made.
I thought that was hilarious.
So he still claims that he actually did kill a Bigfoot, but he's never shown evidence of it. So that's one of the more famous hoaxes just because he made a ton of money off of it. All right, so Philip Stevens, he is a cultural anthropologist at the University of Buffalo. He said pretty much, it defies all logic, and this is a quote, it defies all logic that there is a population of these things sufficient to keep them going. What it takes to maintain any species, especially a long-lived species, is you gotta have a breeding population. That requires a substantial number spread out over a fairly wide area where they can find sufficient food and shelter to keep hidden from all the investigators. End quote. So
do you mean live species?
Yes.
Okay.
So he's saying like, because the video came out in 1967. So they're saying for a Bigfoot to still be around and people still reporting sightings, like there'd have to be a ton of them around to reproduce. There'd have to be, they'd all have to be like in somewhat hiding because there's no like firm evidence out there. And then you got to factor in the climate change and the food supply issues and all of this other stuff. So he's just like, culturally, doesn't really seem possible. Other people have talked about Gigantopithecus. Gigantopithecus?
Sounds right.
This is an ape-like creature that died out about 300,000 years ago. They have found fossils of it, but only in Asia. They said it could have migrated here. Who knows? But again, died out 300,000 years ago. So not sure if that's a plausible explanation either. So we're going to talk about the Patterson-Gimlin footage and debunking it. Like Sarah said, it was released in 1967. So Tom Biscardi, he presented testimony about the filming of this, saying that it was all staged and it was all a prank, saying that it was a man in a suit named Bob Hieronymus. Mm-hmm. Bob came out. He didn't come out initially because he thought, due to the fame and the widespread phenomena that this movie kind of started, that he would be paid for his services. Of basically being Bigfoot, mm-hmm. but they never paid him. Patterson and Gimlin never did. So he's like, screw them. I'll go ahead and say, hey, that was me walking in there. And then in addition to that, Philip Morris came out and he said, hey, I made a suit just like that and sold it to Patterson around that time. So he said, I sold him an ape-like suit. I didn't want to come forward because he didn't want to harm his business because he makes like costumes and stuff. He's like, you don't want to like something that's getting widespread attention. You don't want to say that's fake because my goal is to make it look realistic. So Morris said, because they talked about how lifelike the walk is, it's very distinctive. It's a wide gait. It doesn't look human. So Morris said, the Bigfoot, and this is a quote, the Bigfoot researchers say that no human can walk that way in the film. Oh, yes, they can. When you're wearing long clown's feet, you can't place the ball of your foot down first. You have to put your foot down flat. Otherwise, you will stumble. Another thing, when you put on the gorilla head, you can only turn your head maybe a quarter of the way. And to look behind you, you've got to turn your head and your shoulders and your hips. Plus, the shoulder pads in the suit are in the ways of the jaw. That's why the Bigfoot turns and looks the way that he does in the film. He has to twist his entire upper body. So he's saying, like, that's why it looks so weird. Like, if you watch the video, like, yeah. He doesn't just, like, look over his shoulder like somebody would. He, like, turns his whole torso. He's saying that's why it looks weird. The only thing I could really find is that, so Bob and Philip, so Bob wore the suit, Philip made the suit. Their stories of the suit differ, like, in how much it weighed, what it looked like, what it felt like. Like, Bob would say that it was very, very heavy, and Philip was like, no, it was really lightweight. It wouldn't have been heavy to wear at all. So their stories kind of conflict there. But Bob did pass a polygraph saying that it was him in the suit. Who knows there? Like you said, Patterson died, so we'd never really know from his side of it. Gimlin is standing by it. He did say recently in an interview, he was like, if it was a hoax, Patterson was all in on it. I didn't know anything. Like, he believes that that was what happened. So he's denying that he's part of any of this hoax. The footstep cast that you talked about was revealed to be a prank in 2002 by Ray Wallace. And he revealed that he made it all up to try to get attention. FBI did analyze hair that Bigfoot experts sent in. J. Cochran Jr., the assistant director FBI in the Scientific and Technical Services Division, said that it was of deer family origin. So the FBI did test some hair, but found that it was in the deer family. And that is about all I have on debunking what you came up with.
Boy, you just sucked the fun right out of this one.
What percentage are you on believing that Bigfoot's real?
I am torn. I really am on Bigfoot. You could argue, though, that maybe they entered because they thought that they would get paid or some money mm-hmm. if they entered the picture.
I think it's...
Because it was a pretty big deal by the yes. time that they came out.
By the time
out.
They finally came yeah. out. I do think it's weird that Philip was like, well, I didn't want to ruin my business. I'm like, that would have given you more business if you were like...
That's what I'm saying. Hey, like, look at this. You could argue that maybe he was saying that because... It actually probably brought him business. If you were to say, well, I made that suit.
Right. And look how lifelike
yeah,
it is.
It was amazing. And it was used in this video. See, it was really lifelike. Yeah. I mean, who knows? Who knows at that point? The only people who know are those two, Patterson and Gimlin.
Yeah.
And Patricia.
And Patty Abe.
Patty Abe.
I believe in aliens more than I believe in Bigfoot.
I agree with that.
I'm probably like 5%, 595 on Bigfoot. I also agree with you, though. I would believe more in aliens than I would Bigfoot.
I'll take it.
Yeah, I would believe more in aliens than Bigfoot.
Bigfoot may be just very shy.
That's our story on Bigfoot, guys. So, conclusion, could be more likely that aliens exist than Bigfoot, though. Thanks so much, guys, for tuning in. We will catch you guys next week.
Okay, bye.
Bye.